On behalf of the family of Brother Roger Penix, I want to thank each and every one of you for being here today to support the Penix family as we celebrate the life and the ministry and the homegoing of Brother Roger Penix. We're so very thankful, so very appreciative. So many of his dear preacher brethren are sitting here together today. We appreciate your presence as well. We appreciate the men on the platform today that will be helping and officiating this service. And we just praise the Lord for the life of Brother Roger Penix. His obituary reads, Reverend Roger Dale Penix went home to be with the Lord February 23rd, 2020. His funeral services are held today. Officiating the services are Pastor Brian Taylor, Reverend Richard D. Hart, Reverend Randy Johnson, and Reverend Dale Bass. Interment will be in the East Lawn Gardens of Memory. A lifelong resident of Forsyth County, Roger was the son of the late Viney Branch Penix and Reverend Albert T. Penix. He graduated from Northwest Guilford High School, class of 67, where he lettered in baseball. Brother Roger, as he was lovingly referred to by all who knew him, was a loving husband, father, and poppy to his grandchildren and great-grandchildren. Brother Roger was the most kind-hearted, humble, and even-tempered gentleman. He was the most knowledgeable and passionate about his belief in the Lord Jesus Christ and the King James Version as anyone could be. He will be truly missed by all who loved and knew him. Survivors include his loving wife of 53 years, Carlotta Honecker Penix of the home, daughters Lisa Chamberlain and Kent of Kernersville, Sarah Martin and Sean of Winston-Salem, and Rachel White and Tim of Climax, son Roger Dale Penix Jr. and Melissa of Clemens, grandchildren Brittany Penix, Megan Enscore and Daniel, Tevin Clayton, Tyler Penix, Ryan King and Nicole, Courtney Murray and Matthew, Kristen Clayton, Austin King and Alex King, great-grandchildren Braley, Brayson, Caden, Zoe, Shaley, Kinsley, and Tate, Brother David T. Penix of Kernersville, and a host of extended family, church family, and friends. Let's pray together, may we? Our Heavenly Father, in Jesus' precious name, we count it such an honor and a privilege to be here today to worship the Lord Jesus Christ in spirit and in truth. For our Heavenly Father, it was you that gave this man of God life. It was you that called this man of God. And dear Lord, it was you that used him all the days of his life. But Lord, let us preachers not be selfish with him. You made him a husband. You made him a daddy. You made him a grandfather and a great-grandfather and a friend to sinners, Lord. We just thank you so much for the life of this man of God. And our Heavenly Father, though we know he is with you, and we know that he's whole, and we know that he's well, and we know that all suffering and all of the struggles of life are over forever, never to suffer again, our hearts are saddened. And so, our Heavenly Father, we ask in Jesus' name for your good grace to be upon this family and these friends. We ask, dear Lord, for your mercy abundant. We pray, dear Lord, for the Holy Spirit of God to speak to hearts today. Father, I believe it would please this man of God to know that someone got saved at his homegoing service today. And there may be someone here that's visiting this service who does not know the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, from the preachers today, they're going to hear the word of God and they're going to hear how to be saved. For that's what Brother Roger spent his life doing. And so, our Father, we pray that you'll overshadow this meeting today. We pray, dear Lord, that you would give comfort as only you can. I pray for these men of God who will be standing here in just a moment. I pray that you'd bless them. Bless the musicians today. Bless the singing. May everything done today glorify and magnify the name of Jesus Christ in whose name I pray. Amen. Before we start our service today, we want to have a congregational song. And I picked this song out and asked the family if it was okay, because Brother Roger had me sing this song several times. He'd just come to me right before service and say, "Preacher, how about singing that Some Golden Daybreak?" Take your hymn book in front of you there. Turn with me to page number 73 if you need the words. And let's stand together. We can sing better when we stand. And listen, sing it out, because Jesus is coming again. Amen. Some glorious morning sorrow will cease. Some glorious morning all will be peace. Heartaches all ended, school days all done. Heaven will open, Jesus will come. Some golden daybreak, Jesus will come. Some golden daybreak, battles all won. He'll shout the victory, break through the blue. Some golden daybreak. Sad hearts will gladden, all shall be bright. Goodbye forever to earth's dark night. Changed in a moment, like Him to be. Some golden daybreak, Jesus will come. Some golden daybreak, battles all won. He'll shout the victory, break through the blue. Some golden daybreak, for the precious family of Brother Roger. Oh, what a meeting there in the skies. No tears nor crying shall dim our eyes. Loved ones united eternally. Some golden daybreak, Jesus will come. Some golden daybreak, battles all won. He'll shout the victory, break through the blue. Some golden daybreak. Be seated. God bless you. Our first speaker this morning, dear friend of Brother Rogers, Pastor Dale Bass, Joy Light Baptist Church in Mount Airy. Come on, Brother Dale.
Amen. Family, I want to thank you for sharing Brother Roger with us. I'd like to say today that Brother Roger was one of those real friends, not a fair weather friend. And they say that we preach our own funeral. And I was thinking that what a message he has preached. What a message. Brother Roger kindly took me under his wings years ago and took a chance on me when I didn't know anything, and I still don't know anything, but he still loved me and cared about me. Brother Roger, if he thought that you was in a valley, he'd call you. He'd try to encourage you. Sunday, when they called, it was such a shock. He and I had talked about this day before, and he did most of the talking. He said, now, Brother Dale said, now, when that day comes, I want you to help my funeral. And then he named over Brother Randy and Brother D. Hart and said, now, I want y'all to do my funeral. And I never thought it'd be this quick. Never thought. And it's hard to say goodbye. It really is. And what do you say? What do you say to the family? What do you say today? There's a phrase found that I found over in the book of Esther that has this thought for such a time as this. And what I'm about to tell you, you already know it. But let me just kindly bring it back to memory. For such a time as this, can I say God gives grace? Amen. God gives grace. Amen. Boy, aren't you glad that God does? Amen. I'm glad we're not alone. Amen. I'm glad God gives grace. And a matter of fact, in 2 Corinthians, he said that my grace is sufficient. Life's not always fair. It's not always easy. No. The load gets heavy to carry, but God's grace is sufficient. Amen. And I'm thankful for the grace of God that will help you today and in the days to come. Amen. You know that as well as I do. But let me just remind you again today that God gives grace. And then can I say God gives mercy? Amen. God gives mercy. I'm thankful for the mercies of God. It is of the Lord's mercies that we're not consumed, because his compassion faileth not. You say, well, this is a sad day. Yes, it is. But it's also a glad day. Amen. I can't explain it. For the children of God, God's children are the only ones that I know can go through the lowland of sorrows and be rejoicing at the same time. I'm thankful for that today. But I'm thankful for the great mercies of our God and his compassion. You say, well, God did me wrong. No, no, no. We're all going to go this way unless he comes. We're all going to face this unless he comes. Hey, listen, just because God come and took your husband away, your daddy away, your grandpa, hey, he's still God. He's still God, and precious in the sight of God or the death of his saints. Brother Rogers, a precious saint of God. I so appreciate him and love him dearly. But listen, God will give you grace. And God, not only that, but he gives mercy in times like these. People want to know how we make it. We make it because of God's grace and God's mercy. And then let me say this. God gives comfort. God gives comfort to his children in times like these. Because he is the God of all comfort. You know, the Bible teaches us, nevertheless, God that comforteth those that are cast down. He knows you're hurting. He knows what you're going through. He knew it before it ever happened. But God's here to comfort you, and he'll be here in days to come to comfort you and give you that strength that you need. Oh, yeah, which is my next thought. God gives strength in times like these. You know, a lot of times within ourselves, we can't do it. There's no way. But I'm glad we're not in ourselves. I'm glad the Lord of glory is in our hearts and in our lives. And he helps us. We're weak, but can I say he's strong? And he's always there for us. For my strength is made perfect in weakness, Paul wrote. You know, we're weak, but thank God he is strong. No matter what we face, God will give you strength for it. And then last of all, I want you to notice this. In times like these, God gives salvation. Amen. He certainly does. You say, how can you talk about salvation at a time like this? Well, I rest assured, I'm going to see Brother Roger again. I believe his family rest is assured that they're going to see Roger again. I don't think there's a one of his family that questions whether or not where Dad went. Huh? No. No. He started out one way and he died the same way. Yeah. But ladies and gentlemen, this is the best time I know of to give your heart and life to Christ.
Amen.
Without it, listen, without it, you'll never see him again. If you want to see your daddy, your grandpa, your friend, you're going to have to be saved. I'm glad some golden day break, we're going to see Brother Roger again. And oh, what an honor it's been mine to be here today. Hey, if it's only just for a moment, what an honor. I told Brother Randy, we were talking, I said, man, we've made a lot of precious memories, haven't we? Down through the years, we've made so many memories. I am the better for knowing Brother Roger Penix. Dear family, I love you. I'm not just saying that. I love your daddy. Sister Carlita, I love your husband. I always have. And the church here, church family, listen, God will give you those things that I have mentioned as well. God wants you to go on and live for him. And one day, there'll be a glad reunion over on the hilltops of glory. It's not going to be long. It's not as long as it has been. We're getting ready to check out. Family, may the Lord bless you and keep you. Church, may the Lord bless you and keep you. Thank you for my time.
Appreciate that message, wonderful message. I thought about Brother Roger, what a friend. You know, the Bible says, he that hath friends must show himself friendly. And there's a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. And that was Brother Roger. If you ever became your friend, he was a friend for life. We grew up together. We went to high school together and elementary school and played football together. And boy, what a time we had, a lot of memories. And then I remember Brother Steve Motzinger, he's here this morning somewhere, and Brother Steve Motzinger and I were friends too, and we were riding down the road one day and seen Brother Roger standing on this property. And Brother Steve stopped the car and we got out and find out what Brother Roger was doing, and he's looked at this property. He felt like the Lord wanted him to build a church here. I'll never forget that as long as I live. And I've got so many memories, and I'm not going to go into a lot of them because I'm going to let these preachers do the preaching. I'm not. But I got to tell you a few things. And I asked Carlotta if I could, and I thank you, Carlotta, for the time this morning. I remember Brother Roger came to preach for me when I was pastoring over here at Valley View Baptist before I went into evangelism. And all our folks just loved him. And Brother Roger, he's one of those unique preachers that can get you laughing in his sermon and crying the next minute. And then Brother Roger could get you shouting because of what he said about Jesus and about heaven. He looked forward to going home to heaven. And he loved to preach. He'd drop a hat to preach if you had to. And but he just loved to preach. And he said something to me one time. He said, Brother Richard, he said, besides serving the Lord and putting God first in your life, he said, there's nothing like having your family first. And I said, you're right about that, Brother Roger. He said, I love my family. And he did. And Carlotta loved you and all the children and grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and would talk about him from time to time, how proud he was of them. And he loved his family, and he loved his church. He loved his church people, too. He just gave his heart and life for this church and his family right here. And then I thought, years ago, I've got 4 children and 12 grandchildren, and 2 of my children are boys. And Paul, he's a hospice chaplain out in California. And our baby boy and baby in the family was Dr. Mark Linderman. And both of them preached their first sermon over here in this building next door. I'll never forget that. And I thought about that many times through the years. This coming Sunday, March 1st, our baby boy, Dr. Mark Linderman, went home to be with the Lord. He's in heaven now, And I thought when Brother Roger and I got the news about him passing away, I thought, what a wonderful time he's having up there with my boy and his daddy and all the other preachers and his mama and all that have gone on before. What a wonderful time he's having up in heaven, surrounded by the love of God all around him. And boy, Roger looked forward to going home and being in heaven and being with Jesus and his loved ones there. And I know if he could stand here today, he would tell you, loved ones, family, friends, church members, if you're not saved, like this preacher said a minute ago, get saved. Get saved. Give your heart and life to Jesus. Brother Roger loved thinking about and going to heaven. I had a preacher friend of mine said he'd seen him up Captain Tom's a couple of weeks ago. Carlotta, you may remember this. Walked by and talked about going home to heaven because his folks are there. And Brother Roger said, I can't wait. He's there now with Jesus, praising the Lord. And someday soon, I believe it's going to be soon, we're going to be there to be with him. I want you to listen to the words of this song. Brother Roger put this in his will, and his family wanted me to sing Zion's Hill. There waits for me a glad tomorrow, where gates of pearl swing open wide, and when I've passed this veil of sorrow, I'll dwell upon the other side. Someday beyond the reach of mortal ken, oh, someday my God only knows just where and when. Oh, of mortal life shall all stand still, and I shall go to dwell on Zion's hill. Someday I'll hear the angels singing, beyond the shadows of the tomb, and all the bells of heaven ringing, while saints are singing, home sweet home. Someday the dark clouds will be rifted, and all the night of gloom be past, and all life's burdens will be lifted. Oh, the day of rest shall dawn at last. Someday beyond the reach of mortal ken, oh, someday my God only knows just where and when. The mortal life shall all stand still, and I shall go to dwell on Zion's hill.
I'd like to begin my remarks this afternoon by first taking just a moment to say to Miss Carlotta, to the children, Lisa, Sarah, Rachel, and Roger, to his grandchildren and great-grandchildren, to his brother David, to his pastor, Brother Brian, to Brian's wife, Miss Lisa, to his entire Welcome Door Baptist Church family. You have been and you will continue to be in our thoughts and our prayers. We are here today to pay our tribute and our respect to a dear friend and a great man of God, Brother Roger Penix. Not only have people from this congregation and community gathered, but many preachers have come. Yes. Preachers who have respected Brother Roger as a preacher and have loved him as a friend. To know Brother Roger was to love Brother Roger. We are here today to show our love and support as well for Brother Roger's family. Not only have we sensed our own personal feelings of grief since receiving word this past Sunday afternoon of Brother Roger's homegoing, but our hearts have been drawn toward his family and his church family. Finally, we are here today to seek, as Brother Dale said, and to receive comfort. We would be less than honest if we said that our hearts have not ached over Brother Roger's homegoing this past Sunday. We are not too proud to acknowledge that we have come here today, trusting that God would minister to our hearts and give us that strength that Brother Dale mentioned a while ago as we continue in our walk with the Lord. It is our human nature, church, to want to understand everything now. But trust requires that we lean and rely heavily on God, even when things seem unclear. Someone once said, the measure of life is not in its duration, but in its donation. When we think of Brother Roger's donation, what he contributed, what he invested, we have much to be thankful for. Consider the investments of love and devotion that he made in his marriage of 53 years to his wife, Carlotta. Consider the investments of godliness and nurturing Brother Roger made in the lives of his children and his grandchildren. Consider the investments of the Word of God that Brother Roger made into the lives of so many people, not only members of this church, but all of the people, including preachers like me, that he had befriended. Consider the eternal investments Brother Roger made in hours of studying and preparing sermons, hours spent in prayer for his family, his church family, his friends, and for the lost. Consider the eternal investments Brother Roger made, all the visits he made while pastoring the hospitals, nursing homes, and shut-ins. Then what about all the doors he knocked on, all the burdens he helped to bear, all the phone calls, all the sleepless nights, all the tears shed, all the sermons preached, all the weddings officiated, all the memorial services conducted, all the souls led to Christ and baptized in 45 years of pastoring this church. Then Sunday, after the morning service, Brother Roger was ushered by the angels into the very presence of God from this place, the place that he had invested over 45 years of his life into, the very place that he loved. I say again, the measure of life is not in its duration, but in its donation. Here in just a little while, when all the words have been spoken, when all the scriptures have been read, when all the songs have been sung, we will stand at the graveside and commit the body of our dear friend, Brother Roger, to the keeping of this earth until the coming of the Lord on that great resurrection day. For his soul is now with the God he so loved and faithfully served. But this is not the end of our dear friend's story, because the memory of his life and the influence of his life remains. The great evangelist D.L. Moody once said, someday you will read in the papers that D.L. Moody of Northfield is dead. Don't you believe a word of it, he said. At that moment, I shall be more alive than I am now. I shall have gone higher, that is all, out of this old clay tenement, into a house that is immortal, a body that death cannot touch, that sin cannot taint, a body fashioned unto his glorious body. Contrary to what we would have liked, our dear friend has taken an earlier flight. But we that are saved will share a common destination. I trust everyone under the sound of my voice, as Brother Dale said, is saved. But if not, be saved today. For absolutely none of us are promised tomorrow. 2 weeks ago this past Sunday night, I had the privilege to sit and to listen to Brother Roger preach what now would be one of his last sermons preached to a congregation. Brother Roger took his text from Psalm chapter 57. And I want you to listen, family, at his message that night. This is for your family. Psalm 57 and verse number 7 is where he took his text. David said this, "My heart is fixed, O God. My heart is fixed. I will sing and praise." And the title of his message was "A Fixed Heart." And he introduced his message 2 weeks ago this past Sunday night by reminding the church that I'm privileged to pastor that in this life there is going to be troubles and trials and tears, and there's going to be many tribulations. He said in this life there's going to be sickness and suffering and sorrow and sadness and storms and separation. He said in this life there's going to be disease and death and disappointments and darkness and difficulties. In this life there's going to be unexpected, unexplainable, and unwanted crosses to bear. But then his message was this. With all that's going on in this life, he said we need to fix our hearts on the way of salvation. He said we need to fix our hearts on the scripture, the KJV. He said we need to fix our hearts on serving God. He said we need to fix our hearts on the right kind of singing. He said we need to fix our hearts on the second coming of Jesus Christ. And he said we need to fix our hearts on the Savior. And he got so excited while he was preaching, Brother Brian, that he got a tickling in his throat. He got to preaching hard. And he said, every time I get to preaching hard anymore, he said, I get this coughing. And he's got him a drink of water. And he preached hard. For many years, Brother Rogers talked about, thought about, testified about, preached about, and even a little bit sang about heaven and our blessed Lord and Savior and soon coming King, the Lord Jesus Christ. And now he is enjoying and experiencing all the sights and the sounds and the scenes of heaven. And I wonder if Brother Roger didn't say to our blessed Savior that day, "Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to me thy great salvation, so rich and free." There's so much more that I can say about my friend, Brother Roger Penix. I met him 28 years ago. He was on WWMO radio station. Some of you preachers remember WWMO out of Lexington. Had a broadcast on WWMO. And so I listened to him preach, and I wanted to hear him preach. And a gentleman in our church who's with the Lord now, he said, "Let's go down to his camp meeting." Went down to the camp meeting, was out there at the old building, and came down here to the camp meeting and fell in love with him from day one. He has preached for me numerous times there at the Marla Road Baptist Church, and I'm so glad that I had the privilege to sit and hear him preach 2 weeks ago this past Sunday night. But I want to close simply by saying this. Brother Roger, my friend, you fought a good fight. You finished your course. You kept your faith. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. You soldier of the cross. God bless you, Carlotta and family. Thank you for the honor and the privilege that I have to stand here today just to say a few words, because there's nothing else that I can say or do or anybody else can say or do, because he's done said it and done it. And one day soon, we're going to see him again. One day soon. Matter of fact, it'd be all right with me before we made it back out to the cemetery if the Lord stepped out on a cloud and said, "Come on up, youngins," and we'll see him again one day.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well. my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ hath regarded my helpless estate and has shed his own blood for my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be sight. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trump shall resound and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul.
I count it an honor to stand here today. There's one wrong thing about it. He's supposed to be preaching my funeral because I'm 6 years older than him, almost. But I count it an honor to be here today. Before me, laying here before me today, is the greatest man of God and friend that I've ever met. I met him 40-something years ago in the old building over here. And from that time, God just put us together, and then God let me come up here and pastor 27 years close by. I could say a lot today. It'd take most of the evening to tell you everything I know about him and all that's good. Boy, we have good memories together. And I thank God that God allowed me in my lifetime to know that I had one true friend and a preacher, Brother Roger Pennies. He was there when I needed him. He was there when I didn't need him. He was there. For years, every Sunday morning, I called him at 9 o'clock. I heard one of the kids say, "Well, Ghost, you remember me?" Call him. Tell him I was praying for him. And if I didn't call him when he thought I ought to, he'd call me. And that's the kind of friendship we had. And I thank God for it. The Bible tells us over in Revelation 22 and verse 10, "Be thou faithful unto death." Be thou faithful to the death. He was faithful man of God. Faithful man of God. He fulfilled this verse. He was faithful unto death. We was preaching together up in Pigeon Forge, Tennessee. Me and him went in on Tuesday to preach. And on Monday night,
Brother Porterfield was preaching and fell dead in the pulpit. And he made a statement that night to me, I'd like to die in the church. God allowed that to happen.
Yes, sir.
And he got his wish. And thank God he's faithful. First of all, I want to say he was a faithful friend. The Bible said in Proverbs 17, verse 17, a friend loveth at all times. I never had one doubt. And I don't remember a time in him's ever talked to one another that we didn't finish the conversation, I love you. Brother Roger Penix had a heart bigger than him. That's why he got hurt sometimes, because he had such a big heart. He had a heart of love, and I thank God for it. We've had some good times together. I preached for him in this church for 32 years, every year for 32 years. He preached in my church for 30-something years, every year. We had that kind of friendship. And we prayed together. He was a praying man. And we'd pray together. If I had a need, he's the first one I called. If he had a need, he called me. We prayed together. That's good memories. They can pray together. Then we preached together. We got to travel together. North Carolina, South Carolina, Tennessee, and Kentucky. I remember was headed out to Rockwood, Tennessee, to go preaching Brother Ben's camp meeting, or Jubilee. And back then, he's having a lot of hard time asleep. He just go to sleep just in a minute. So I was driving. My grandson was with me. And we was going up 81. And he'd fell asleep. And they had one of them big signs just about that, probably 6 foot wide and tall. Said, buckle up. He woke up by the time we got even that sign. He said, if they got a sign out that big, I better buckle up. My grandson would never forget it. Preached together. In Rockwood, they nicknamed us Mutt and Jeff. We was at the motel room one morning getting ready to go to the camp meeting. I was up shaving. And he woke up and he said, Brother DeHart, I dreamed I was riding a motorcycle. I said, yeah, and you had that motor running too. Because if you was ever around him, he snored. And I'd try to get in bed and go to sleep before he would. And he'd go to sleep on me talking to me. Yeah. But we're friends. And I thank God for it. Then we praised together. But we had a lot of things to praise God about.
Amen.
Then we shared problems with one another. You know what a true friend is? He'll share problems with you, but he don't share that problem with nobody else. He don't run and tell somebody else. And I can tell you this tonight, this morning, or this evening, there's things that he's told me that I care to the grave nobody ever know about. Same with him. I could tell him something, I didn't have to worry about it going nowhere else. He said, preacher, I'll pray about it. That's a friend. That's a friend. And I thank God for it. And this is not the end of it. Amen. We're going to see him again. I'll share this with you and go on. I talked to him last Thursday. We talked a long time. And he was talking to me about something about going home, different things. We had a good talk. He told me I loved him, told him I loved him, and hung up. And when I did, the Lord said, it ain't going to be long. Brother Roger's leaving out. I didn't think it was going to be 3 days later. I thought it was going to have children. But God prepared me for it. But I'm going to see him again.
Amen.
I got news for you. He's not dead. He's alive. I told him a while ago, I said, I can just see him when he walked in. Pop was there, that hand out, welcomed him out and said, I've been waiting on you a few days. Been waiting on you a few days, amen. It's just time don't mean nothing up there. And they're having a glorious time right now. Amen. But then also, now is he faithful friend? but he was faithful to his family. How do you know that? Boy, he loved his family. Sister Carlisle, he loved you. I can remember many times coming in, we'd be going to the store or something, or going out, and he said, I got to get my sweetheart something to carry home. I don't know if she remembers this or not. One time up on page 40, bought her a sign. It said, bury me close to Walmart when my wife abused me. Often. Remember that? She's kidding about going to Walmart. But anyway, he loved her. Children, he loved you. Grandchildren, in-laws, all of you, he loved you. Thought God for you. You know what he's saying? All of you, meet me over there. Don't let that circle be unbroken. Meet me over there. Live for me. Be faithful. Told me many, many times, the most important part of my life is my family, to live faithful to God. That's what he said. He said, the only thing I worry about leaving is I want to make sure they live for him. So live for him. He left you a pattern. And let me say this to you while I'm on this to the family. Forget about the bad times, hard times in pastoring. Remember the good things that you've had with your dad. Good things. He loved Sister Carlisle. He loved his children. And matter of fact, I don't know nobody he didn't love. He was a loving man. He's faithful friend. He's faithful to his family. But thirdly, he was faithful to his flock. 45 years he put in here. I've seen it all grow. There's an old building, seen it all grow. He put a lot of hours in, a lot of prayers in. He prayed about everything, and God used him, but he was faithful to his flock. He loved Welcome Door Baptist Church. I've been in meetings when preachers get up and run their members down. I've never heard Brother Roger Penix ever run his members down. He may be having problems, but he didn't run his members down. He loved them. He loved them. See, it's hard. I never could run my members down because they was the one that was feeding me. Amen. They just want to take care of me. And I didn't agree with them about everything, but I still loved them. And Brother Roger was faithful to this church for 45 years. He was faithful to preach the word. It's one thing you don't have to worry about when he walked behind the pulpit. The book was going to be preached. You didn't have to worry about it. He's going to preach it like it is. He preached the word. And that's what God charged him to do. Preach the word instantly. It don't matter whether they like it or not. Preach the word of God. Preach the word of God. Then he practiced the word of God. Amen. He was an example. And 2 Timothy 4 tells us we'll be an example to the youth. An example. He was an example. He didn't preach you to live a life and him go out there and live something else. He lived what he preached. And if he preached it, you can bank on it. He's going to live it. He practiced it. Then he prepared in the word of God. He prepared. He studied. Why? He wanted to feed the flock of God. See, that's what God called the man of God to do, to feed the flock of God. And he loved Welcome Door Baptist Church. And you had one of the greatest, and you've got a good pastor now. I'm not done. Brother Roger Penix is a great pastor. Great pastor. So today, we'll just look to him. The Lord's soon coming. Family, Sister Carlisle, Junior, Lisa, Sarah, Rachel, Brother David. This is not the end of it. The Lord's coming back one day with a shout. Amen. And you're going to hear Roger said, been waiting on you a few days. You've been there. Going to see him again. Thank God he won't be in the wheelchair. He'll have both legs. Amen. And I get there, he said, Brother D.R., I know you're tall now, but I'm going to outrun you. Amen. So just look to him. He's coming. Look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of faith. Let me say in closing today, and I know he'd want me to say this. If you're lost today without Jesus Christ, there was nothing more important to this man, Brother Roger Penix, than somebody getting saved by God's grace. If you're not saved, today's a good day. Matter of fact, today's the only day you plant, you know of. Today's the day of salvation. And he said, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Shall be saved. Philippians chapter said, what must I do to be saved? He said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house. Salvation is something that you need to die with. Because if you die without it, it's not going to be a happy ending. Amen. It don't matter what the devil tells you, it's not a happy ending. One of the greatest things that ever happened to me is when God saved me by his marvelous grace. And he wants to do that to you today. So each one of us, a church family, look to him. Oh, yes, he's going to be missed. Oh, you're going to miss somebody like Brother Roger. But you know what he'd say? Just keep on living for God. A few more days, we'll be home. And what a day that's going to be.
Amen.
Amen. What a day. I was thinking what Brother East was saying that song, Mingo. I was just hearing Brother Roger up there saying, it's well. It's well. It's well. Thank God. Thank you again for letting me stand here today. And I could say much more. But I believe I said what God wanted me to say. But I just want you to know, I love Brother Roger. And I love his family. And I'm going to miss him. Going to miss him. But I'm thank God. I know this is not the end of it. I'm going to see him again. Glory to God.
It's my desire
that certainly was his desire, was to live for Christ. And he didn't do it in word only, he did it in deed as well. I want to share this with all of you from his children. He never looked for praises. He was never one to boast. He just went on quietly working for the ones he loved the most. His dreams were seldom spoken. His wants were very few. And most of the time, his worries went unspoken too. He was there, a firm foundation through all our storms of life, a sturdy hand to hold on to in times of stress and strife. A true friend we could turn to when times were good or bad. One of our greatest blessings, the man that we called Dad. There's so many scriptures that you can turn to when you want to honor a man of God who's gone to heaven. The Lord laid upon my heart this days of this week a verse in the book of 1 Samuel chapter 9 and verse number 6. These words were spoken of the man of God Samuel. And it says, "Behold now, there is in this city a man of God, and he is an honorable man. All that he saith cometh surely to pass. Now let us go thither peradventure. He can show us our way that we should go." In the city of Kernersville, North Carolina, there was an honorable man of God. His name was Pastor, Reverend, Brother, Honey, Dad, Grandpa, Great-Grandpa, Poppy Penix. He was a man of God that stood on the truth of the Word of God, the old King James Bible, and nothing else. This church he started was founded on John 17, 17. "Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth." Only the judgment seat of Christ will reveal how many people Brother Roger showed the way of heaven to, and showed them that the only way to heaven was through faith in the shed blood of Jesus Christ. He truly lived his life for his Lord, for his family, and for his church. I want to personally thank you, Carlotta, and Lisa, and Sarah, and Rachel, and Roger Jr., and Brother David, for sharing your loved one with us, and moreover, with the world. We're all better for knowing this man of God from Kernersville. Brother Roger was a preacher, but not just a preacher, he was a friend to preachers. Brother Roger was a pastor, and a friend of pastors. And for me, since 2006, when my pastor went to heaven, he's been a pastor to a pastor. And I'm not the only one. But God, in his infinite wisdom and in his will, unbeknownst to me, God had the plan for me to be his pastor. That was a daunting task to walk into this place. That God only used one man for all of this to come to pass. And to fill those shoes and to step into those shoes. But it didn't take me long to learn something. I can't fill Roger Penix's shoes. Roger Penix filled Roger Penix's shoes. I have to fill my shoes. And he was my pastor. And he was my counselor many times when I was pastoring at New Birth and I needed some godly counsel. I called Brother Roger. And he always led me right. But not only was he a preacher and a pastor, but he was a friend of sinners. who needed to hear how to be saved. For nearly a half a century, Brother Roger Penick served the Lord Jesus Christ faithfully and steadfastly. And he endured many trials of the physical, trials of the spiritual, and trials of the ministry. But through it all, he never gave up, he never gave in, and he never gave out. Brother Roger reminded me of the words of Paul in Acts chapter 20 and verse 24, when Paul said of those trials and his tribulations, "But none of these things move me. Neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I may finish my course with joy, and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God." My dear friend, and my pastor, and my member, this verse sums up his victorious life of service to the Lord. And as Brother Randy Johnson reminded me on Sunday when I called him to tell him that Brother Roger had gone to heaven, he said, "Now, preacher, you know there's not one thing any of us are going to be able to add to his life and his ministry. He's preached his own funeral." I want to read a quick passage of Scripture and share it with you, and then we'll pray and we'll move on. Brother Roger, of all the things that have been said, all of it true, none of it embellished, all of it right down the line, gun barrel straight, just like he was. But one thing I'm going to remember about Brother Roger is that his life mattered. His life mattered. I mean, he changed the world in which God had put him for the better, for the glory of God. In the book of Joshua, chapter 24, verse 29, "It came to pass after these things that Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died, being 110 years old. And they buried him in the border of his inheritance in Timnath-Serah, which is in Mount Ephraim on the north side of the hill of Gash. And Israel served the Lord all the days of Joshua, and all the days of the elders that overlived Joshua, and which had known all the works of the Lord that he had done for Israel." Now, as I speak these things over these next couple of minutes, I'd like you to think about Brother Roger. I want to say that his life mattered to God. It was God that saved him. It was God that convicted him of his sins and showed him his sinful nature and caused him to realize that he needed to be born again. And Brother Roger, his life mattered to the Lord enough that the Lord sent his only begotten son into this world and went to the cross and died and gave his life and shed his blood for Brother Roger, but not just for Brother Roger, but for all of us. Then the day came when God called him and said, "I want you to preach my word. I've got a job for you to do." And just as Joshua was, Brother Roger was obedient to his calling. He never forsook it. He knew he was obligated to his calling. He couldn't stop if he'd wanted to. And I can't speak for all these preachers in here, but I'm sure that all of us, including Brother Roger, at one time or another was ready to write a resignation. So I've had it. I'm done with this. But there's a fire burning down inside that won't let us quit. He was obligated to his calling. He was observant of his calling. He did what the Lord asked him to do. Faithful to the end. A life well lived. But not only did his life matter to God, but his life, Joshua, his life mattered to his nation. And I can say of Brother Roger, his life mattered to this church. Because you see, he led us by his example. It's already been said, he didn't tell the church what to do and then go live another life. He lived in front of the church. And he labored with this church together by faith. And he left a work that continues. When Moses died, God raised up Joshua. And he told him very plainly in Joshua chapter 1, Moses, my servant, is dead. There's no blinking at that fact. Our dear brother is no longer with us. He's in the presence of the Lord. But the work goes on. The work will not cease. The work he started under the leadership of the Lord will continue on. He heard me say this many times, and so has this church, that we're not going to forsake the old paths. We're not going to forsake the old time religion. We're not going to forsake the old time singing. And we're not going to forsake the King James Bible. We were founded on truth, and when God comes to get the last one of us and somebody tears this building down, we will have not forsaken the truth. So not only did his life matter to his God and to his church, but his life mattered to his family. Loved. And he loved. You see, he lived his life in front of them. He didn't have a secret life. He didn't have a church life, a secret life, and a home life. He had a life. And he lived it in front of his family. And to this dear family, he's left you something that money cannot buy. He left you a goodly and a godly heritage for you to continue. And then he's left all of us an example of faithfulness to God to follow. I know that Sunday morning was extremely hard. It was hard on all of us. It was such a shock. Just stood there just literally minutes before looking at him preaching the word of God. And the next minute I'm counseling with a young man, and one of our ladies comes running down the hall to give us the word, and we go into action. But though it was shocking, you got to see something that a lot of people don't get to see. You got to see your husband and your daddy finish well. He left out standing where he stood when he started. Never compromised, never changed. And this great, tremendous auditorium of people will be a living testimony of the impact this man of God from Kernersville had on all of our lives. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Our Father, in Jesus' precious name, though this is a service of homegoing, though the world calls this a funeral service, Father, my heart's been touched with a bit of revival today. As we account and remember the life of a steadfast, faithful man of God who lived what he preached and preached what he lived and never forsook you, Lord. I know where he's at. I've had people in these last days tell me, just like they did, they said, "We sorry you lost your preacher." I said, "I ain't lost him. I know exactly where he's at. And he's awaiting for us. One of these days we're going to join him and all of the others that have gone on before us. Lord, I do pray for grace and mercy and comfort for this family, not just today, but also in the days, weeks, and months ahead. And Lord, I pray for us that you would help us to live faithfully, that you'd help us to finish well, that you'd help us, Lord, to live for you. And may our lives matter for more than just us, but may our lives matter to those that you put in our lives, as you did our dear brother Roger. And now, Lord, we ask you dismiss us from this portion of the service. Bless our travel to his place of rest. And dear Lord, we thank you for the life of Brother Roger Penix. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand together, please?